Well, welcome back to Loaded Landscapes. My name's Simon Plant, and today we're going to look at lens choices for landscape photography. I think most beginners who come into photography to shoot landscapes will naturally grab a wide-angle lens, maybe a 24 or 28mm lens. You've got this beautiful view in front of you, and you want to capture it all. But that's not necessarily the best approach every time. And this is what this video is about today. I'm going to show you different lenses worked in different scenarios and get you thinking about how different lenses work and how that can kind of make you stop and think, what do I want to show in this scene and what's the best lens to use to capture it? And it's not always the wide-angle lens. So we're going to start off with this image. This is an image I captured in Mallorca in Spain on a beautiful island on a very sunny morning. And we've got this fence, and I want you to keep an eye on this fence here in this picture, and this will come up again a bit later on. But keep an eye on this. We'll go back over this image in a second. So this is the first image I captured, and I came from a normal camera height, which for me is 5'7", and I decided to come up. So this is like stood on a box or something, I can't quite remember. So I'm slightly elevated. The next image was my normal camera height at eye level, and then this one I came down a little bit lower. Now let's go back over those, and like I said, keep an eye on this fence here and how the camera height affects that. This is our normal, slightly elevated camera height. This is our normal, and this is our lower. Now, I'm using a 28mm lens, as I said, so it's a wide-angle lens. Now, things with wide-angle lenses, they will change the perceived distance in between objects in a scene, but they also affect objects that are closest to the lens. You'll get a lot more distortion to elements that are closer to the lens. So in this case, as I've come down lower, this fence post is obviously much closer to the lens here, and it looks quite wide here, and then it converges and gets narrower and narrower, and that's actually giving kind of an element of depth to the picture. As it's tailoring off, it's showing that the scene is getting smaller, that fence is getting smaller as it recedes into the scene. So it gives you that kind of bit of depth into the picture. And again, I'll show you another example of this later on. So that's just from different camera heights. So let's go back over those again. That's slightly elevated. So if I wanted a bit of a if I absolutely needed to use a wide angle lens, but I didn't want too much distortion, an elevated camera height in this image, avoids too much distortion. I mean, the fence panel doesn't look here like there's too much convergence going on. That's with the 28mm lens. With this one, there's a little bit more convergence, and then obviously with the one at a lower angle, there's a lot more convergence. Let's try another image that might demonstrate that a little bit better. This is a picture of a road. Okay, a shot on a 15mm lens. So this is a normal camera height. So for me, about 5'7", that's my eye level. As I come down, you'll see that the road changes shape. It's flattening out a little bit. Here we've got quite a lot of convergence going down the road, and the same with these, same with this fence panel. And as I come lower, the road isn't converging quite as much, and then the real low shot, there's hardly any. So what I'm kind of showing you here is that your camera height with a wide angle lens can make quite a difference on the elements in your picture, especially if you've got leading lines moving away from you, like this fence, the trees and this road. It can make a big difference. So there's the normal camera height. Look at the road. There's a slightly lower, and then that's getting down really low, and that's on a 15mm lens. So again, these leading lines change dramatically depending on your camera height. Okay, so back to sunny Spain again, same location. Lens compression. Depending on the focal length of your lens, that will compress your scene in different ways. And this is one of the reasons that I don't tend to use wide angles very often. It's not a rule, obviously. No photography fundamentals are kind of rules. They're there to be broken. And when you start breaking them is when you can get creative. So what I'm telling you is kind of the fundamentals of photography. But it doesn't mean you've got a stick and anything is right or wrong. It's a creative decision. But knowing the fundamentals will help you make those creative decisions. So back to what I was talking about. This is about lens compression. So this is the same scene. I've not moved much in these three pictures. I've just changed the focal length of the lens. So this was shot on a 70mm lens. And again, I want you to keep an eye on the fence here, but also keep an eye on the background and how big it is. So 70mm. This was shot on 100mm. And then the last one, 135mm. Okay, now you have to sort of kind of see past that, you know, obviously we have zoomed in and we're losing a bit of the foreground. But if you look at the kind of middle ground here and the background, look how it changes. 70mm. Then look at the 100mm. And you can see the background and the foreground here, or the middle ground in this picture, have come almost like closer together. And then finally, they're really compressed. So what's happening here? Well, remember I said in the last bit, on a 28mm lens, it can stretch the perceived distance of elements in the scene. What that means is, on a wide angle, these posts would appear wider apart, and obviously they get smaller and smaller as they go into the image. With longer lenses, they tend to squeeze those elements closer together, so it makes those elements look closer together in the shot. So again, 70mm, then 100mm, and then the 135mm lens. So it kind of squeezes everything together. So that can be quite useful. So let's see another example. This is a set of trees. This one is shot on a 17mm lens. And look how far apart these tree trunks are from each other. Then I shot it on a 70mm lens. The trees haven't moved. And I haven't moved that much. It's the lens has changed the perceived distance between the 17mm and the 70mm. So they look closer together. So this image, if you wanted to show kind of, you know, give it a more of an impression of distance between these objects, between these trees, then a wide angle lens is great for that. However, if you want a bit more of a softer approach to this and make everything look a bit more kind of compressed and the distances bring them everything closer together, the trees closer together, or the perceived distance of those trees being together, then a longer lens does that really well. So that gives you an idea of that in action. And I want to show you another one in terms of compression. Here's that fence panel we used in the other image a bit earlier, with the 15mm lens. Look at the posts. I want you to keep an eye on the posts here again. Okay, that's 70mm. So not a wide lens, but that's 70mm. That's 160mm. So you can see nothing's really moved. The fence panel, those posts haven't moved, but the lens is squashing them together and making them look closer together. So how does that affect our landscape photography? So I'm going to show a few of my images and how I use this knowledge to kind of make, well, what I think is probably better images. This is a scene that I went out very early one morning, not far from where I live. I live in an area where we've got these wetlands, and I know that at certain times of year we get mist. So I wanted to try and go out and capture some of this mist. Now this was a perfect scene. We've got these trees leading down this field with some bluebells in, and we've got this backlit mist. Doesn't get any better than that. Light coming behind a misty scene is just the most beautiful light. To accentuate that, with a wide-angle lens, this probably would look quite nice on a wider lens, but I knew that with a longer lens, it would compress this background and it would compress these trees leading down. But what it also would do, it will, obviously being a longer lens, have to cut through a lot more of the atmosphere in the air. Therefore, it would help accentuate that mist more. Okay, and this turns what would be a beautiful landscape into more of a painterly looking landscape. It's a little bit more flattened, and it just works really, really well using a slightly longer lens. Doesn't mean that you would go out and photograph it in the same way, but again, it's using the knowledge of how these lenses, different lenses, affect the look of the scene that helps you start to get a bit more creative. Here's another scene, very similar, with a wide-angle lens. This wouldn't have worked as well, in my opinion. But again, it's simplicity, it's compressing the scene with a long lens, and it's also helping cut through a little bit more of that mist. On the other end of the scale, as I said, I don't use wide angles very, very much, but there is a time and a place for them. And remember that walkway I showed you in Mallorca? This image is one of my best-selling fine art prints. Now, the reason for that, I think, is that when you see this on a wall, you can almost feel like you're walking through this reed bed on this walkway. And the reason is that I used a wide-angle lens here on this picture. I think it's a 28mm. And again, you almost feel you can put your hands on these railings. And that's what the wide-angle does in certain situations. You almost feel, as the viewer, that you could actually walk on this walkway. So, you know, as I said, I don't use wide angles very often, but there is a time and a place for them, and in this certain image, that worked really well. A longer lens would not have worked as well for this particular image. Absolutely not. So, there's a time and a place. One last image. I'm just going to throw this one in, getting back to this distortion. This was shot in Venice, and literally, right behind me was a canal. And I could not go back any further. So to shoot this image, I had to get down low, and I had to use a very, very wide-angle lens, something like a 15mm lens. And because of that, we've got all this distortion going in. It's acceptable. People accept things leaning in. And also, if you can go wide enough and you can crop into the image, there's a lot of great tools now in Photoshop that will help you correct distortion in your images. Okay, so there is help out there. And finally, I want to show you one other thing. You might be asking, well, what if I want to sort of bring these background element closer to the foreground in a landscape, but I don't want to use, I want to show a bit more width in my images. So I want kind of a wide angle shot with more compression. It's not possible. Well, there is a way, and let me just finally show you to finish off with the way I get around that. So how do you shoot wide but get that compression? Okay, or as I like to call it, having your cake and eating it. Okay, so that is a really, really good question. This will crop up. You know, you want to show maybe this background. There's a bit of a church on top of here, but maybe you want to show an element on the headland here and want that larger. And obviously, with a wide-angle lens, this is going to go much, much smaller in the scene. I'm not talking about the boat because the boat was actually composited in. It was there, but it's really, really small in the scene. So I'm not going to mention the boat. But that could also be an element that you could use for this scenario. But let's say there's something on the headland here, and with a wide-angle lens, you've got this lovely foreground. But this cliff and this whatever elements on that cliff is going too small. So you think, right, okay, well I'll use a longer focal length, and that will compress and bring these two images much closer together and similar in size. The trouble is there, and you're probably going to crop the image around here. So the way around it. Pretty simple. Ideally use a tripod, you don't have to because the software again is very good now. You shoot a panoramic, so you shoot maybe two or three images in succession, and you go back into Photoshop later after you process your images and you stitch a panoramic. That way you can go as wide as you want to but still use a slightly longer lens. Another example, again, you might want something in the foreground here to be quite large, and you want to bring that background closer together. Again, this is a panoramic. I think this is two images that I shot in a landscape format. And again, you can stitch them together and crop it, so you can still get your width, but you get that compression. Probably not the best image, that one, to show you. This one might be a bit better. On a wide-angle lens, you've got this big kind of dip in the rocks here, but the background obviously goes much, much smaller. Again, the solution, shoot with a longer lens and then do a stitch to get your width that you want. Let's see what other examples. That's another similar picture I did there. I wanted to keep this sign quite large in shot. With a wide angle, I would have to perhaps get closer to that sign than is possible. So by using a longer lens, I can make that sign bigger in the frame together with this cliff in the background. But then I lost lost this side of the image. Solution, you know, if you can get back far enough, move back, zoom in, and do a panoramic. So there is always a solution to that if you still want to get that lovely compressed look to the image, but you still want that kind of wide angle, that width. The solution is to take two or three images and stitch them together. Maybe we'll do a video on that. We'll have a word with my editor at Loaded Landscape, see if that's something we want to cover. That may be for a future video. So there you go. I hope you've enjoyed this video, and I hope you've learned a few things about your choice of lens and how it affects the image that you want to capture. And I hope to catch you in the next video. Cheers for watching.